Kobe had a Hall of Fame career in two jerseys. As number eight, he played 10 seasons, had close to 19,000 points, 24 points a game, 707 games, won three championships. And then look at number 24, Brez, almost identical in terms of the production. Crazy.
Did you put this graphic together?
No.
This is amazing, Geet. This is good research right here. I didn't realize it was that close, 10 of 10 seasons. I mean, two completely different mindsets, too. Obviously, eight, kind of the brash, up-and-coming teenager, figuring his way out in the NBA, powered to win three championships with the brute force of Shaquille O'Neal. And then kind of the elder statesman, Kobe Bryant, the veteran, pushing and pulling the Lakers to two more titles after they acquired Pau Gasol in February of 2008. Love seeing Pau here today. Hopefully Lamar Odom will be here as well. A couple of their players from those teams. But, Gee, I just love that the two completely distinct types of careers that Kobe had. But he was the exact same guy, trust me, mentally, for all that.
When I say Kobe, does 8 pop into your head or is 24?
24, only because I covered him for a lot more in 24. I really did get the second half of his career when I was a writer at the LA Times.
Yeah,
how about you?
It's just crazy to think that 24 enters my mind now, too, because there was a time where I thought it was only number 8.
Yep,
but that is
no
Kobe
doubt.
Being Bryant. All right, enjoy this. The ceremony, the statue unveiling for Kobe Bryant, 2-8-24. Kobe forever.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. 2-8-24. What an historic occasion. At this time, will you please welcome the president of Crypto.com Arena, Peacock Theater, and LA Live, a warm welcome for Mr. Lee Zeidman.
What a calming voice. It's always great to hear Lawrence Cantor make an announcement. You know you're at a historic Laker event. Good afternoon, and on behalf of the Los Angeles and Lakers and AEG, welcome to Crypto.com Arena and LA Live. I'd like to thank you all for joining us today as we unveil our 12th statue and 7th Laker legend at Star Plaza, and to honor and celebrate one of the most incredible athletes of all time. And one of the most important people in the history of this city, Kobe Bryant. As the first employee of what was then Staples Center, now Crypto.com Arena, I know quite a bit about how this arena was constructed. And the more time I spent watching Kobe play here, the more I understood why many refer to this as the house that Kobe built. Now, part of my job involves watching a lot of sporting events. I could tell you in my 40-plus year career and being involved in over 6,500 events, I have never, ever saw anybody with Kobe's ability light up a crowd, take a game on his back, and change its outcome with his immense talent and sheer force of will. There is absolutely no one more fitting to be recognized here at Star Plaza with a statue than Kobe Bryant. And it's a great pleasure and honor to be part of what we're doing here today. Now let's take a look back at some of Kobe's most iconic moments on the court.
I don't think the Pacers really had any idea of the confidence or the ambition that was inside of me. I've had sprained ankles in middle school and high school, and I've had ankles really, really swollen. I played through them. So you know, I've played through pain before. It was just a matter of playing well at the highest level against top level players.
Now you know that Kobe's gonna take over the game. Kobe is gonna try to attack.
Here he is over Jackson. How good is this kid?
8 seconds remaining. The final game of the regular season. The Lakers looking for their 56th victory. Kobe with it, guarded by Patterson.
Now at that moment, it just became about finding some gap where I could elevate and get a good look at the rim.
Staying outside the arc, dribbling. Patterson keeps his feet. Kobe forces. Oh! He made it!
This crowd is in complete shock.
the shot to win it, that was vastly more complex.
1 second remaining in double overtime. The Blazers lead it 104-102.
Theo Ratliff came out of nowhere. And he was so close to block. I mean, he was like a fingernail away. I just had a lot of motivation that game.
Deep three, got it!
Dell was on the other side. I said, okay, this is my time. This is my chance to pay Dell back for not playing me all those minutes my first year.
I don't believe it! Okay. 62 for Kobe.
I take it back. He is good, but he has more than Dallas has.
And that summer, I put a lot of time in the gym. I put a lot of time on the track. I could run all day and run at a high speed all day long. So it's like there could be games where I do have 80 points. I felt like I was having a special night when Lamar kept reminding me that I was having a special night. And every time out, he comes to me and said, you can't get 50.
And Dunk Lakers lead.
Well, that's 51.
And the next time he just looks at me and goes, you can't get 60.
Kobe goes straight for the dribble. 61 points.
And then by the last time he says, well, go and get 80 then.
And an 81 point game. Listen to this crowd for number 8, Kobe Bryant.
It's game 4 between the Lakers and the Phoenix Suns. Tied up, reaching.
Luke winning the jump ball was the most surprising thing that happened that entire game. Once I had control of the ball, then the rest of that part was easy for me because it was just doing things that I've done in the gym thousands of times.
Final seconds. Bryant for the win. Bang! The Lakers take a 3-1 lead as Kobe Bryant at the buzzer in overtime.
Well, I wasn't shooting the ball well at all. You have to look at other areas of the game where you can have a material impact. There is no other option. We have to win it. I don't, by any means necessary. Come hell or high water, we're going to get this thing done.
And look who comes down with another rebound. It's 15th of the game.
You know, I still have to be able to carry the threat of the shot and open things up for my other guys.
Bryant looking. Artest, that's a three.
Bang! The Lakers repeat.
This is the sweetest. This one's by far the sweetest because it's against them and because it's the hardest one by far.
I could feel the electricity as I was pulling up to the arena. At that point, I was just thinking to myself, okay, you got to go out and perform. You can't stink it up tonight.
Jump fake. Fade away. Good.
Kobe for three. Up it goes. And down it goes.
Are you kidding me?
So tired he can barely pick his feet up.
You know, my legs were tired, but I said, listen, this is the shot.
Pulls up, two-pointer, good! If I wasn't sitting here, I wouldn't believe it.
It's hard to believe that it happened this way. It really is. Like, I'm still in shock about it. It's unbelievable.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, there is one man in American history that has said Kobe Bryant's name more than anybody on the microphone. Every preseason game, every regular season game, every playoff game, home and away, celebrating his 37th campaign as the longtime television voice of the Lakers, a warm welcome to Stu Lance.
Thank you, Lawrence. As Lee said, this is such an honor to even be associated with this day, 2/8/24. I did see a lot of what Kobe had to offer, and it was special in many, many ways. I told the quick story about what sold me on Kobe as a rookie. I think we were on the road in Detroit or somewhere. We had a couple of days off and had some days to practice. And he wasn't a starter then. So they had a scrimmage at the end of practice, 2-7. He lost both games. After he lost the second game, he came over. I was sitting on the side on the bleacher by myself, and he came and sat not too far away from me. And I looked over at him, and I saw a tear rolling down his cheek. And I thought to myself, wow, if losing hurts that much, we've got ourselves a winner. And lo and behold, we had ourselves a true, true winner. He was a talent beyond talents. The things that he could do on the basketball court, most of us could only dream of. A sad day when we had to say goodbye. So to get the story and this program started, I want to introduce some of the people that are going to be giving you some wisdom and some stories about Mr. Bryant. As I call out their name, they'll enter the stage. First, the lovely Vanessa Bryant. Next, Phil Jackson. Next, I think we have a statue of him as well, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. A longtime Laker and teammate of Kobe Bryant's, Derek Fisher. And last but not least, all of our boss, Jeannie Buss. Jeannie would like to start the program off by being the first at the mic.
Thank you. It's my great honor to be speaking here today on behalf of the Laker organization, and it's an even greater honor to be speaking on behalf of Laker fans. There are many things for which I am thankful to my father. Near the top of the list is when he declared to Kobe, "I want you to be a Laker for life." Trading for Kobe back in 1996 set this franchise and this city on a journey that was beyond our wildest dreams. We all know the numbers tell a story. 20 years with one team, 33,643 points, 18 All-Star selections, a league MVP award, 2 NBA Finals MVPs, and the one that mattered the most to Kobe himself, 5 NBA championships. Every one of them achieved here in Lakers purple and gold. Those points, those wins, those points, those wins, those trophies, they weren't just statistics. They were moments that transported us and brought joy to Laker fans across the city and around the world. I have spent almost my entire life around sports, and I can tell you I've never met or witnessed anyone like Kobe Bryant. Everyone who watched him play the game knows he did things on the court unlike anyone else. He was a scrapper, a fighter, a winner, and he was also an artist, and he could bend the world to his will. I think that is what my father meant when he said seeing Kobe play was like watching a miracle unfold. An NBA team once offered to trade us 5 players in exchange for Kobe, but Dr. Buss declined, explaining that Kobe was as rare as a flawless 5-carat diamond, and 5 1-carat diamonds would never equal the same value. I think of Kobe constantly and miss him and Gigi more than words can say. But today I am filled with joy because in the future I know fans will gather here in the shade of this statue besides this building where Kobe gave us so many memories, and we will share what he meant to us. And as we do so, we will motivate a new generation to emulate the Mamba mentality. And might I add, I bet we will see photos of a marriage proposal that takes place right here, inspired by the true love story of Kobe and Vanessa. That is why I'm so grateful to be here today with his family to celebrate him and make sure that his legacy endures. In 2009, 13 years after telling Kobe he wanted him to be a Laker for life, my father described Kobe as a marvel. He was, he is, and he will always be. Thank you.
This gentleman has played alongside Kobe and was one of the rare players that really, truly developed the respect that Kobe wanted from everybody. Derek Fisher.
Thank you, Stu. Bear with me, guys. This is a celebratory day, but one that is definitely personal. Vanessa, thank you for allowing me to be here. Natalia, Bianca, Capri, this is special. Your dad, as you know, and your husband, one of the greatest human beings, not just basketball players, one of the greatest human beings to ever walk this earth, and one of the greatest basketball players to ever touch a basketball. So no matter what people ever try to tell you later about who the GOAT is and all that, remind them, okay? today we gather not only to, we still mourn the loss of obviously my beloved teammate, but to celebrate the extraordinary life of a leader, an inspiration, and a true culture shifter on and off the basketball court. In the realm of sports, Kobe was not merely a great player. He was a dedicated father. Like some of the stories, when people ask me my favorite Kobe stories, I go to the father stories. I go to the girl dad stories. He was dedicated to that, as these girls know and Vanessa knows. He was a dedicated father, a pillar of strength for his family. His commitment to fatherhood was unwavering, just as his dedication to the game was. He intentionally balanced the demands of competition and family life. And I'm personally still in awe of how, on the rare days off that Phil Jackson used to give, Kobe still found the energy to go to Disneyland with the family on those days off. That impressed me almost more than anything he did on the court. But he wasn't just a champion, he was unmatched. His prowess, a rare specimen that left opposing players and all teammates inspired. He didn't just play the game, he defined it. Like that's really what it was like to be around him on a daily basis. He set the standard, he broke records. The legacy he leaves behind are foundations upon which current players and future players build their dreams. His leadership went beyond scoring points. I know people only think of him as scoring points, but he passed, I know. I was the beneficiary of many of those passes, and it was about fostering a winning mentality. So when we talk about the Mamba mentality, it's not just about you. And for the guys and girls that wear the shoes and wear the jerseys, and you talk about the Mamba mentality, if you ain't winning, you ain't winning. And that's what the Mamba mentality was also about as well, to push everybody to be their best, not just you. He was often the heartbeat of our team, a guiding force that propelled us to greatness. His impact extended well beyond victories. It was about shaping character, instilling a sense of pride and confidence in all of us that wore the purple and gold. In the realm of basketball, again, he wasn't just a player, he was a legend, like an actual living legend. That's what it felt like to be around him. His name now etched in the annals of sport forever, a beacon that continues to guide aspiring players. The echoes of his accomplishments will reverberate in the aspirations of those who wear his sneakers today. As we continue to remember our fallen basketball angels, Kobe, Gianna, and the people we lost that tragic day 4 years ago, let us not just dwell on the sadness of how that feels, but let us today and forever moving forward celebrate the greatness that their lives represented. Kobe transcended basketball, the boundaries of the court. He touched the lives of all of us who had the privilege to know him. So in his memory, let us continue to strive for excellence, lead with unwavering dedication, and be the culture shifters that define the legacy of a true legend. Thank you.
Although this gentleman didn't get the opportunity to play alongside Kobe, he got an opportunity to watch him quite a bit. The Cap, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar.
Good afternoon, everyone. The first known statue was made 35,000 years ago, which was around the time, thank you. The first known statue was made 35,000 years ago, which was about the same time that I entered puberty. And not much has changed since then. People still have a deep need to pay homage to those among us who represent the best versions of humanity. This statue may look like Kobe, but really, it's what excellence looks like, what discipline looks like, what commitment looks like, what love of family looks like. The fact that all those qualities came in the form of an exceptionally handsome man is just a bonus. Coach Wooden used to frequently quote Benjamin Franklin's line, "By failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail." When I was on the Lakers coaching staff, I had the opportunity to watch Kobe practice. I had never seen a player prepare with such focus and determination. It is the one thing to want to excel, but it's another to drive yourself to acquire the necessary tools to excel. Kobe's relentless determination made his teammates push themselves too. He made everyone around him play better. Kobe once said something that has stuck with me ever since. He said, "I see the beauty in getting up in the morning and being in pain, because I know all the hard work that it took to get to this point." He was referring to the physical pain that all professional athletes learn to live with in pursuit of excellence. But his statement is even more profound than that, because we all arise from bed each morning, each day, with some pain, the pain of lost loved ones, the pain of lost dreams, the pain of aging out of relevance. Yet we endure that pain because it's the worthwhile cost of the daily joys and delights we experience in loving and dreaming and in growing older among family and friends. I like to think of athletes as artists. Like the painter or poet, the athlete offers a temporary distraction from the struggles of life, as well as the keen insights that struggles that helped lessen the weight we all carry. We batted our hands in amazement as we watched Kobe defy the laws of gravity and movement as he leapt, dodged, and pirouetted from one end of the court to the other. He was a defender's worst nightmare. And that was entertainment. We learned from him that the limits of what is physically possible can be expanded, given enough effort and enough heart. That was insight. That was Kobe. A statue is a wonderful contradiction. It captures a person frozen in time, while at the same time acknowledges that the reason there is a statue in the first place is because that person is timeless. We're all here today to honor a man who represents not just extraordinary sports achievement, but also timeless values and inspire us all to try harder to be not just better, but our best. Thank you, Kobe.
Not a lot of people can say that they had the opportunity to coach Kobe Bryant, but this guy obviously had that opportunity, made the most of it, and together they won some championships. Coach Phil Jackson.
Vanessa, Laker, management, Buzz family, and those players that have played championship games for the Laker uniform. Will you stand up in this audience, you guys that have done that, and were teammates, some of you, with Kobe Bryant? Thank you. I had an initial talk when I came to the Laker organization and Jerry West had provided a room for Kobe to meet with me. It was private prior to the ceremony. And he talked about the fact of how many hours he had watched the former team that I coached play basketball. And he was ready to step into that, and he was ready to win championships. He was 22. Now, I have twin boys that are exactly a year younger than he is, 21. And being a father that has semi-delinquent children, I knew that this guy was much more serious than the children I was raising. He was very serious about this game. We struggled, Toby and I struggled a lot the first year. It was, I will tell you, like looking at Michael Jordan and Come Fly With Me or whatever that video was. He had everything, all the markings, the way he posed, the way he held himself. It was almost amazing. And there were times I would pull him to the sideline and say, don't try to take over this game. It's not time. Don't try to take over this game. But he was dying to do so. And he was ready to do so. I arranged a meeting between Michael and Kobe to give him a little impression of how to handle being in a restricted basketball system that relied on passing the ball to available teammates and wanting to go one-on-one with this guy in front of you. So I arranged, we had a little meeting in the cigar room and off the bar downstairs, and Michael and I were sitting there, and Kobe walked in after a shower and the press and whatnot, and he sat down and he said, Michael, I can take you one-on-one. And Michael said, well, I think you might. I'm 37, you're 22, right? But that was part of his growing up years. And his teammates would come to me and say, you know, Kobe never goes out with us. He's always in his room. He's watching tape. He's doing this and that. But he's not really associating with us. And so I pulled him aside and I said, you want to be captain of the team someday, don't you? And he said, oh, I should be captain now. I said, Kobe, you don't associate with your teammates. You're separate and apart. Well, all they think about are girls and hubcaps and cars and whatever. I'm watching the game. It's a serious business for me. And that was how he was. We wondered, was this going to happen? Were there times, so many times, when I had to kind of pull him over to the sideline and say, not yet. It's not time yet. Go inside. Feed Shaq the ball. He'll get it to the open man. When we went into the playoffs, the answers were proven. You all remember various items that happened. One, the lob pass to Shaq in the seventh game of the Portland series that year. The Indiana series when he tore up an ankle in the second game when Rose put his foot underneath him and he landed awkwardly and sprained his ankle. The fourth game in Indiana, he came off during an overtime and won the game for the team, and Shaq picked him up and carried him off the court and said, my little brother won the game for us today. And that's the making of a dynasty that happened those 3 years. And then there was a year of discontent. Shaq didn't get an operation until the season started. And Kobe, who was serious about maybe winning four in a row, not three in a row, wasn't enough. He wanted four in a row. Kind of held it against him. But I had to say, you know, basketball is basketball. And you have to play the game with what you got and how you come to the understanding of what your team's going to be in this particular year. The fifth season, we went to the finals, fourth time in 5 years. Difficult year. Gary Payton, Karl Malone were on our team. Karl was injured. Horace Grant was injured in the finals. And we struggled and lost. Devastating loss. Most devastating thing that you can do as a coach is survive after a loss in the finals. I don't know if players feel the same way, but I'd had it happen both as a player and as a coach, so I know the intensity of it. Coming back from a sabbatical, that's what I call it, to take the reins of the Laker team over again, Kobe and I worked out a pact. This time, let's cooperate and collaborate. And that we did. We collaborated on how we're going to get a center, Pau Gasol, to fill the gap. We collaborated on the players that were playing at a higher level and needed to have a boost or needed to have some kind of a charge put in them. Over the years, I've given him books on leadership. Winnie the Pooh in leadership. That's right. And the Tao of leadership. And Kobe absorbed them, and that initial feeling of how much better am I than my teammates would always kind of survive and surface and come to the edge. I don't know if you remember this, but he scored 50 points inside of three quarters one time against Dallas. I benched him in the fourth quarter. A lot of fans didn't appreciate that, but we were up by 25, 30 points, and I said, no, that's enough. We're going to win this game, and we're going to save some motion for another game on another night. But the night he got 81, we needed all those points. They were running a zone against us, and we devised a little offensive system that would exaggerate Kobe having a one-on-one opportunity with our power forward, a small forward, or Jalen Rose. He ate that up. There are two things that made me proud of Kobe and who he was. In the year of our discontentment, we had played a game on Tuesday night here in LA and flew up to Portland. Mardi Gras, I didn't know it was Mardi Gras until I got to Portland. The streets were still reveling with drunken young people at 3 a.m. And we always had a kind of a statement about the NBA, bags at 2:30 or 3, about maybe 4. You might get in at 2:30 or 3 and maybe get to bed. The next morning we were staying in the Benson Hotel and I was sitting in the lobby reading a paper at 9 o'clock in the morning waiting for my staff to come down for our meeting before shoot around, and I got a tap on the shoulder. It was Kobe. He'd been to mass, he had ashes on his forehead, and I knew he was working on himself. Important. The seventh game of the playoffs against the Boston Celtics in 2010, Kobe was having a horrible game. He ended up being 6 for 24 that night. And we kept saying to Kobe, stay inside the system. Don't go out on your own. Keep it moving. Keep the ball moving. Hit the open man. Make the motion that we have to go through. He finally got into it. We won the game. Ronnie Artest hit a 3 down the stretch, which was big. Sasha capped it off with a couple of free throws that were down the stretch. And we celebrated a highly intense rivalry. Jay Leno had the team, invited the team to go on a Tonight Show, and about 7 or 8 of them came on the Tonight Show, and some of them were in the front, some were sitting in the back on chairs. And as Jay Leno was trying to make humor, he said, who's this guy that was always in a uniform, or never in a uniform, or always dressed, that's sitting behind you right there? And Kobe said, don't make fun of Adam Morrison. He's one of our teammates. He puts in the work. He may not get to dress, but he puts in the work and he's part of our team. And then I knew, that's when I was the proudest of Kobe.
Begin. When it was Staples Center then, and there used to be a saying about, I guess there still is a saying, behind every great man there's a great woman. No. Beside every great man there's a great woman. I don't know if you remember this, Vanessa, but it was maybe the first year, second year that Staples opened, and we were in the family room, and I just commented to you about you should give a seminar on how to raise children. I had never in my long life met more well-behaved children than the Bryants. It was truly amazing. That discipline to do things of that nature obviously was within the family. Kobe was great at what he did. Vanessa, you're great at what you do. Welcome, Vanessa Bryant.
Thank you.
It goes without saying that today is an especially sad day for us, since Kobe and Gigi aren't here for what is supposed to be an incredibly joyous moment in Kobe's legacy. I want to thank you all for being here and showing your love and support for Kobe and our family. I'm thankful for all of the fans, including those watching and supporting from home. Kobe has so many people that have supported him all over the world from the very beginning. And this moment isn't just for Kobe, but it's for all of you that have been rooting for him all of these years. And to the fans here in LA, this is a special city Kobe was so proud to represent. You welcomed him with open arms and have been so important to him, our family, and his legacy. It brings me joy to see how much love you have for all of us. We love you back. I'd also like to thank Jeannie and Linda for their hard work in helping me with the statue and in making this day possible. So much goes into this process, and I'm really grateful for everyone that helped make this special day happen. And for the record, Kobe picked the pose you're about to see. So if anyone has any issues with it, tough shit. It is what it is. Because fans all over the world and the City of Angels loved Kobe so much, he will have three statues in front of the arena, also known as the house that Kobe built. One wearing the number 8, one with our beautiful daughter Gianna, and one wearing the number 24. Julie M. Ronnie worked on this particular statue and did a great job of capturing the moment Kobe wanted, while adding the details I requested to make it all come together. One detail you may notice on the statue is that all of our daughters' names are tattooed on Kobe's arm. Although some of our girls weren't born at the time of that particular moment, that specific detail is for Kobe. A few additional elements that I requested to be added to the statue are Kobe's 5 championship trophies, Kobe's career accolades, the Sheath QR code to watch Kobe's highlights pertaining to the statue on your phone, and the triangle-shaped base as a nod to Tex Winter and PJ's triangle offense. Clearly, it was that trio's favorite shape. As a matter of fact, Kobe and Tex spoke so much about scoring within the triangle offense that I often saw triangles in my sleep. Now you'll get to think of them too. Thanks, PJ. Phil, Kareem, Derek, and Jeannie, you meant a whole lot to Kobe. We appreciate you for being here and sharing your memories of my husband with us today. As I see today's current generation of star players follow in Kobe's footsteps with huge scoring games, I know he would take pride in knowing that he is still pouring inspiration into the game that was so special to him. I don't want to reveal too much about the statue before you see it, so I'll leave you with one of my husband's amazing quotes. Leave the game better than you found it, and when it comes time for you to leave, leave a legend. And that he did.
and gentlemen, on your feet to honor the Mamba, Kobe Bryant, the new statue.
We want to thank you all for your attendance today. I know it's a day you all always remember and always keep Kobe in your hearts. Go Lakers. I want the rest of all of you to come this way.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Tomorrow morning at 10 a.m., the statue will be available for Laker Nation and fans around the world to come visit here at Crypto.com Arena.
Wow, Mike. I usually don't call you Mike. What a moment.
Unbelievable.
What a moment. If you don't have chills right now, I don't know what to tell you, because that was something extraordinary. What a speech by Vanessa Bryant. The unveiling and the breaking news that there will be three statues. Right here's the number 8. And by the way, it's the one that Kobe picked. And if you have a problem with it, tough you know what.
Yep.
Be another one, Gigi, Kobe. And then the third, you can guess, number 24.
What a day out here, Geet. You can hear fans way behind us chanting his name. Unfortunately, it's kind of a smallish crowd in that tent, just put up for weather purposes. And Geet, just love this right here.
Look at that.
Synonymous with when he scored 81. 18 years and a month ago. And it's really, I love the details Vanessa provided in a very eloquent speech that I'm not going to forget anytime soon, that he's got his daughter's names emblazoned on his arm. He's got a little nod to the triangle offense there. Thanks to, and Kobe had a love-hate relationship with the triangle. He did say once, it's boring as hell in December and January, but it wins you championships in June. So there's no doubt about that. And I just love so many of the great names, the Laker legend we heard from today. I thought Phil Jackson was great.
You can listen to stories forever.
Yeah. I mean, I can't wait to do this again two more times, hopefully, when we add two more statues, right? Yeah. But Derek Fisher, you know, Stu, wonderful job emceeing, and on and on and on. Always good to see Kareem out there. Geet, that's a packed house below us. Yeah. So many former teammates of Kobe's, whether it's Lamar Odom, obviously Pau Gasol, Devin George from the first incarnation of those three championship runs. And just an amazing, amazing day, Geet.
You know, so much to unpack.
Yeah.
But I said this in the pregame. If you're a Laker fan, if you're a Kobe fan, millions of them around the world, how many conversations you've had with your friends, your colleagues, about what the statue was going to be. And to find out that when Kobe was alive, this was the one he picked. And when you break it down, Brez, that's the iconic moment for Kobe. The greatest game that I've ever seen played. You were there. Championship Sunday. You talked about it in the pregame. Kobe Bryant walking off the court after scoring 81 points against the Toronto Raptors. And as Phil Jackson, his coach, said today, you needed every single one of them to win the game. And that's what Kobe was about. Remember, he did have 62 and three quarters against the Mavs.
They were up
by 32, so he didn't play the fourth. Going on for 100.
Yeah. This was not that type of game. Neither of these teams were playoff bound. You could already kind of tell in January of 06. And he scored 26 in the first half. And I remember thinking, okay, we've seen that before. Okay, you know, nothing too crazy. They scored 27 in the third quarter and 28 in the fourth to get to 81. Second highest total in NBA history. NBA started in 1949, Geet. Yeah. That's a long time. So to think that is still the second highest total ever. I remember the aftermath of the game as well. You know, your friend and mine, Luke Walton, played in that game. He still likes to tell people about the night that he and Kobe scored 81 together. And he went up to Kobe right after the game. Remember game tickets? You used to have ticket stubs. And he gave Kobe a ticket stub. He said, will you sign this for me? So Kobe signed the ticket stubs. Jerry Buss was around the locker room. I interviewed him that night. Never forget, he said it was like watching a miracle unfold. Just an amazing game, top to bottom. Phil Jackson, obviously the coach at the time. He said, I've seen a lot of stuff in the NBA. Never seen a game quite like that. So just an amazing image from an amazing night right here inside these walls a little over 18 years ago.
I'm sure Laker fans can resonate with how I feel because I was born and raised a Laker fan. I've lived here my entire life. And there are certain moments that you will always remember. And I remember 4 years ago talking about Kobe and saying, you know, he was ours. Mm-hmm. For 20 years, we watched the evolution of Kobe Bryant, and he gave this city every single thing he had. I love that Vanessa said this is also about the fans. Let's go down to Allie. She's in the tent with Big Game James Worthy.
All right, thanks so much, Geeter. Well, Big Game, it has arrived. The statue is here. Your thoughts?
You know, I miss Kobe so much, like everyone else does. Anybody that he came in touch with, you know, he made a special moment in their life. But this unveiling of this statue is amazing because it almost comes alive looking at it. You can feel Kobe. You can see Kobe. You can hear his voice. And I've seen all the statues. This one is extremely special. And my hat's off to Kobe. And especially Vanessa for what she's done and the day she's given us. It's a special day.
You and I both were standing inside of this tent, and the public has yet to see it unless they were watching from home. But to hear the crowd reaction, they came down to be a part of this despite having to watch it on television. What does that say about Kobe and what he meant to the city?
I've heard that people have come from Taiwan, Germany, all over the world to be here. That's how much he impacted people's lives. But the city of Los Angeles, Kobe, he really didn't care about the attention, but he was around this city a lot. After games, giving shoes to homeless people on his way home, he had a special pulse of this city. They knew him. They knew him more than on the court. They knew him as a person, and that one was so special about Kobe. He really, really was the pulse of this city while he played here.
We get to talk to you all the time about different stories and moments that you take with you, being around Kobe, being inspired by Kobe. To listen to all the stories of those that were close to him as well, what did it make you feel?
He was, you know, he had such a way of asking questions. A lot of times he would pull me to the side to ask questions about footwork and stuff like that. And then he was so determined. And I think that's what you hear in people. He didn't have any hobbies. He gave 110% to us. And I'm a former player. And I feel like he just gave so much to me as a former player, to the game, to continue what a lot of old players started. He just took it to a whole nother level. The dedication, the discipline, the way he approached the game. I've never seen anything like it. And we all think we approach the game second to none, but Kobe was a student of the game. He respected the game. He knew his history. He knew the history of the game. And like someone said, he didn't go out. He was in the room watching games, you know, getting ready. So we've never seen anything like it, and we miss him.
I know how much he meant to you, so thank you for sharing that all with us. Thanks, Big Game.
My man, Kobe, we miss him.
All right, thanks, Big Game and Allie. 2-8-24 will go down as a special day in Lakers history. We will have more from Kobe's statue unveiling when we return